please, let's give her a welcome and we're going to get started.
Thank you, Marie. Okay, are we good? I'm so excited to be here. One thing too, I was a kindergarten teacher for 18 years, so where are the kindergarten teachers out there? You are definitely my peeps. Those are probably the happiest years of my life, and especially around the spring. Isn't it so exciting because the kids are really consolidating all the skills we've taught them, and they're on fire for reading. So I'm so excited to be here today and learn with you and learn from you and talk about phonemic awareness, which is one of my favorite topics. So that's my contact information. If you want to contact me afterwards, please feel free to do so. I am a crazy person on Facebook. If you're one of my Facebook friends, I met some folks here tonight. They said, oh my gosh, I love your Facebook page because you're always posting things on literacy. I have four grandchildren. Their names are Lola, Layla, Leo, and Lily. So do you think they're good at alliteration? But I say my fifth giant passionate love besides Lola, Layla, Leo, and Lily is literacy. So I post a lot of literacy in all four of those wonderful grandchildren, and also tons on Twitter at Live to Learn. So would welcome to continue the conversation. Okay, so we'll see if we move there. All right, so PATN is the Pennsylvania Training and Technical Assistance Network. In the state of Pennsylvania, the state system of support for school districts works like this. At the state level, we have the Bureau of Special Education and the Pennsylvania Department of Education. And under that, we have three large technical assistance centers, PATNs, in Pittsburgh, in the Philadelphia area, and in Harrisburg. And our role and function is really as professional learners, or as professional learning for the state of Pennsylvania. We develop content and deliver content throughout the state, and we also work with our intermediate unit partners, which there are 29 in our state, and they work with our local education agencies too. It is a wonderful place to work. It requires constant learning, and I think that's why my Twitter handle is Live to Learn. I love working there and helping teachers. I have the best of both worlds. I get to learn, but I also get to serve in classrooms and be with kids almost every single week. So it's a great place to work. All right, and this is our commitment to least restrictive environment. Okay, so here's our roadmap for tonight. We're going to have a little bit of research around phonological and phonemic awareness. We have been conducting a research study on advanced phonemic awareness, and I want to give you a little feedback about how things are going. So I always think if I'm going to implement something, it's nice to hear from folks who are actually doing it with real kids and look at those results. So that'll be a brief overview. For the most part of the night, it's going to be a lot of hands-on. Have you ever heard of I do, we do, you do? Okay, so we're going to be doing a lot of that through these phonological and phonemic awareness skills. So you are going to be needing a partner tonight, so we'll talk about that in just a moment. We'll briefly just talk about assessment, and then you have some homework. One of our colleagues developed this wonderful Padlet that has 9 different sites that have all wonderful free resources for phonemic awareness. They're all based on the evidence. So that's just something for you to take back when you go back to your classroom, but I strongly encourage you to do that homework because especially if you're thinking about small group instruction, everything is pretty much done for you. So you can look through those sites and then have resources. All right, so we are going to be actively engaged after we go through a little bit of the research tonight. You are going to need a partner. So you need to find somebody you can partner with tonight to engage in these practices. One of you says, I'm going to be a one. The other one says, you're going to be a two. Now, here's the trickiest thing about that, is remembering which one you are. That's why I put stickers on your table. So ones and twos, and I'm going to bring you back with a zero noise signal like this. So choose your partners, and I'll bring you back like this. Okay, so if you see this, you do this too. Thank you. Awesome. Thank you so much. Okay, so let's test it out. If you're a one, raise your hand. If you're a two, raise your hand. If you're a two, raise your hand. Okay, good job. All right, and then if you see this icon here, this means that there's a handout for you to look at. I also will be asking you, if we're looking at some slides, I might read them a little bit, and then I'm going to stop. That means I want you to chorally join me in the places that I've stopped. So it's a little bit more interactive. I also will do something called Fist to Five. Are you familiar with that? So if I'm bringing something up and I want to kind of gauge your knowledge for that content, I'm going to say, well, give me a Fist to Five. And I'm going to give you some think time, and then I'm going to say, show me. So, for example, if you knew a lot about the topic and you'd say, Dr. Kastner, move on over, I'm coming out to do it, right? You'd show me a 5. But if it was the first time you've ever even heard this topic, it might have a 1 or a 0. But it'll help me scan across the room and formatively assess where you are, so I can either deepen the knowledge or back off a bit, okay? All right, so we're gonna start that right now. This is Scarborough's reading rope, okay? Think time for a fist of 5. Okay, ready? Show me, nice and tall. Wow, I think this is the only audience where I've ever seen something like that, so that's awesome. All right, so you are, that's right. Okay, so we're just gonna go over this briefly. Now, Scarborough's reading rope is an enhancement of the simple view of reading from Goth and Tunmer from 1986. And the simple view of reading says, a skilled reader with comprehension really focuses on the production of word recognition and language comprehension. So these two big domains, and it's a multiplication problem because we can't have it's not an addition problem because 1 + 0 would be 1, correct? So let's say we had a 1 in word recognition and a 0 in language comprehension, we'd still come up with 1. But it's a multiplication, it's the outcome of that, because we know we need both, right? So what Hollis Scarborough did is she expanded on that, and she took those components and showed you the critical components underneath. So under word recognition, we have phonological awareness, understanding the speech sounds of our language at all different levels. That means at word boundaries, stress patterns, syllables, onset and rhyme units, and phonemes. And then we think about decoding. That's when we map graph beams onto those sounds of that we have just learned. That's the phonics piece. And then, of course, sight recognition. And you guys are very, very fortunate because you have Dave Kilpatrick. When I say sight word recognition up here, I know you know what that means, that any word that a child can read as if by sight, accurately and automatically and instantaneously. And when those three components work interdependently together with repeated practice and they become strong, kids develop a strong sight word vocabulary. So you notice at the bottom that the lower ends of the rope are braided together. So they need to become increasingly accurate and automatic. So we free up that cognitive desk space for kids to bring meaning to what they're reading. And then at the top, of course, language comprehension, background knowledge, vocabulary, language structures, verbal reasoning, and literacy knowledge. That's around all kinds of language and listening comprehension. And we know that we need both. Because as a teacher, I often had kids who may be accurate and fluent with word decoding, but when they were done reading it, they didn't know what that meant, right? They didn't have the language to bring to it. Do you have kids like that? Conversely, you have children. I'm sure if you read the story to them and they were listening to the story, they could tell you all about it. When you speak to them, they have great oral language and vocabulary, and they know have a lot of domain-specific knowledge in certain areas. But when they get in the code, what do? They crash. Right? So can a child ever get to reading comprehension if they don't have the code down strong and accurate? Yes or no? No. So I always like to quote Anita Archer, who says, no comprehension strategy is going to compensate for a child who cannot read the words. Right? So this is Hollis Scarborough's reading rope. Usually what I like to do, we don't have time tonight, but I actually have ropes. And we create this together and we go in a little bit deeper. But we don't have as much time tonight, so you already have 4s and 5s. Okay, so phonological awareness is the conscious awareness of all levels of the speech sounds that we talked about. And underneath this, whenever you see phonological awareness, do you see an umbrella? I always see the umbrella because underneath that we have this subset that's a lot more sophisticated of phonemic awareness. And we know phonemic awareness means the individual speech sounds of the language, the ability to be consciously aware of them. Not just to have a working knowledge of them, but to have a conscious awareness of the speech sounds at the individual level, and also be able to manipulate those sounds. And that is really, if you want to think about where the money is, it's right there in phonemic awareness when we talk about phonological awareness. Rhyming, of course, is important. Syllable knowledge, onset and rhyme unit is certainly important, but it's really at the phoneme level that we can really make a difference for kids. Okay. So this is one of those slides that I'm going to read some, and then you're going to read the rest with me. Ready? The lack of phonemic awareness is
the most powerful determinant of the likelihood of failure to read.
And that was Marilyn Adams in Beginning to Read. I'm sure you've read that. That's a seminal text. If you have not, it's definitely one to read. Now let's look at that date. What date is that, everybody? 1990. What year is it? 2019. Right? So sometimes the research, it takes a long time to get into practice, right? So we've known the importance of phonemic awareness for 30 years nearly, correct? So not only is it important, it is the most important. So it certainly means we should be paying attention to it in our instruction. And the thing is, you could be 5 or you could be 105. If you are a nascent reader, you must have and need phonemic awareness. If you teach middle school, if you teach high school, if you have students who cannot read or are having word recognition problems, it's likely at the phonological and phonemic awareness level. It's something we have to uncover and discover to see. All right, so let's read the next one. I'll stop and then you start. Research indicates that without direct instructional support, phonemic awareness eludes. Are those who come from less literacy-rich backgrounds. Furthermore, these children have serious difficulty in learning to read and write. Okay, so again, this is a 1990 quote, but Maria mentioned Marianne Wolfe's book, Reader Come Home. And are you seeing kids coming to your classrooms with less oral language? Yes or no? Give me a thumbs up or thumbs down, nice and big. I know, even when I left the classroom, I saw that kids were coming with less and less oral language. And the more technology creeped into our lives, there was less and less robust oral language with our kids. That profoundly impacts not only, but think about the upper ends of the rope, their background knowledge, their vocabulary, all of those areas, but it's we know it, thank you.
That was Dan.
Dan, you are my savior. I'm telling you, he's saved me twice tonight. Okay, so we know this early on, right? When they're in preschool, we can see this, all right? So as I told you, I have 4 grandkids. They're 9, 7, 5, and 22 months. What was I doing when I was driving them around in the car? Hey, let's play the put together game. Okay, listen to my sounds. K-at. Oh, then we'll play the take apart game. I said cat, now I want you to take it apart. Or rhyming games, right? So I'm playing all of these things with my grandkids. And the great thing about phonological phonemic awareness is I can just do it with my mouth, right? I don't need anything with me. Now they always say about phonemic awareness, you can do it in the dark. But should you? No. And the reason why is, I want my grandchildren and your children to see my mouth, lips, teeth, tongue. I want to talk about, is your voice box turned on or off? I'm here to tell you, if you are teaching phonemic awareness, you must be teachers of language. You must know the speech sounds of the English language. You will amplify any curriculum that you're teaching exponentially for your students. If you are teaching the speech sounds of the language, it's your responsibility, if you're teaching phonemic awareness, to know how to teach those speech sounds to your students. Okay. All right, so we know this from speech school, and this is from Anita Blackman up here, so we have to read this one together. Okay? Speech school aids children in awareness and quality of the speech sound. The court drawn into the letters have been shown to hold
singular predictive power.
It's absolutely so essential. And as I said, it's for anyone who's learning to read. Why? Because we have an alphabetic language. It's actually morphophonemic, but tonight we'll talk about how our language is an alphabetic language. That means we are using an alphabetic code to represent the speech sounds in our language, right? So this is something we've done so that we can make learning permanent. But if we think that we can teach students to learn to read by visually memorizing visual strings of letters, we are so wrong. We cannot memorize every single word of the English language. We have to use the code, and we begin with speech. As Louisa Mote said, it's speech to print. We begin with speech. Same thing when we think about the upper ends of the rope. We begin with speech and oral language and scaffold that onto the written. All right, so why should we engage in direct, explicit, systematic, advanced phonemic awareness? Because we need to move beyond blending and segmenting. And unfortunately, a lot of the assessments out there only go to blending and segmenting, but we need to be moving kids into manipulating the sounds of language. Our instruction needs to progressively differentiate the internal structure of the spoken word so that kids can develop these robust, deep, accurate phonological representations that they map sounds onto. Okay? Here's some more research just to tell you how important phonemic awareness is. Most kids, not all, but most kids, if they have a reading problem, almost always, not always, but almost always, the core of that is a phonological deficit, all the way down to the sound level. But so many of our interventions intervene with just phonics, with the sound and the print together. But you guys know, because of Dave Kilpatrick, that if we want to really move kids forward, remember his three-legged stool? Aggressively trained phonemic awareness. Teach letter sound knowledge to proficiency and use decodable text for accuracy and fluency. And then wide reading. When they can read, the barrier to reading comprehension is often in language comprehension. They don't have the experience of the background knowledge. You and I are the same way. You think you're a proficient reader. I think I'm a proficient reader. But I have a brother-in-law who is a dean of biology in Michigan. Every time I visit him, I look at his research. I can accurately decode it like the wind. Do I have any meaning with it? No. I don't have the background knowledge. I don't have the vocabulary. The sentence structure is a little bit different, right? So even you and I, we can be in the same place, right? So at always, these two things are working in tandem, word recognition and language comprehension to skill reading. All right, and then Dave talks about orthographic mapping. Dave basically set the world on fire. I saw Marie on the way up here. He is the nicest man. He has been to Patton, I think, three times now. He is humble. He is brilliant. I don't think he knows how brilliant he is, but orthographic mapping has really set the world on fire and really made the case for advanced phonemic awareness, that manipulation of sounds. So really what Dave's thinking about when he talks about orthographic mapping, let's just say this is speech sounds. All right, so this is a little bit of Velcro here. We started out with speech sounds matching speech to print with the letters of the alphabet, correct? The ones that are the most common. And then we move to digraphs, blends, and what have you. And what we're doing is increasingly lengthening, right, the phonemes that kids are holding into their into their phonological lexicon, and then we're mapping on. So we want kids to be increasingly aware of the internal structure of the spoken word. Do you have kids who, when they are reading, they look at the first letter and they guess, yes or no? Are they paying attention to the internal structure of the entire word? No. Where can we scaffold them first? Orally. Those phonemic sequences have to be in their phonological lexicon in that sequence so they can map on the sequence of the letters. It begins here. All right? So we want kids to have instantaneous access. So that when they look at that word, they no longer have to say dog. They just see it and they say dog. That's what orthographic mapping is. And it starts with phonemic awareness, advanced phonemic awareness, training kids to hear those speech sounds all through every part of the word. Now we start out with what? We start out with maybe a sentence, the cat ran down the street, and they ask the kids to listen to those word boundaries and then tell us how many words. Then we move to syllables. I might say table and ask the kids to put it together, table. Then we go to onset rhyme. I say k, at, and you put it together. And then we begin with phonemes, k, at. Or we might just begin with a VC, at, right? Or a CV, g, o. Then we move to a CVC, then a CVCC. And a very logical sequence from larger to smaller. But kids need to be proficient at every level. That phonemic proficiency at the word level, at the syllable level, at the onset rhyme level, and the place that really makes a difference at the phoneme level. Okay? So I think I lost my clicker. Oh, it is? Okay. So what we're trying to do is get those phonemic sequences into long-term memory so we can map on those graphemes to that. All right, so this is how, this is from Dave's book, page 92. So how do phonemic awareness and phonics work together? So these early phonological skills of rhyming, segmenting into syllables, and onset fluency help kids be aware of letter names and sounds. Okay, at the basic level, blending and segmenting. Okay, that's phonic decoding. That's that blending and segmenting when they say dog, or then they put it together, dog. But just because a child can phonically decode doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to build a sight word vocabulary. That's where we were for many years. We were kind of stuck in this blending and segmenting and phonic decoding. And then Dave illuminated the research to us again from Linnea Airy, Joe Torgerson, about how important orthographic mapping is, that mental process that readers use to store written words for instant and instant access, right? So that involves deletion and substitution of phonemes. All right? So I asked my friend Jackie. So we have a little research roundup for you. And this is just some more research. I don't want to stand up here and talk to you about it. You're just going to put it on your table. You're going to talk to a partner. And we'll just share out maybe one or two. So we'll do that real quick. Okay. I'm going to bring you back. Okay. Thank you. Thank you in the back. Yay. Thank you. Okay. So just walking around, one of the quotes that really seemed to hit people was the Shaywitz quote. So I'm just going to pull that out real quick. The Shaywitz quote was one that really resonated with people. Around 88% of the dyslexic population, defined as those who experience unexpected difficulty learning to read and write, share a common phonological weakness. Okay. One of the books I'm reading right now is this one. And actually, I'm going to do a book chat on it. But anyways, Phonological Awareness, From Research to Practice, from Gail Gillen. This is the second edition. And this is a quote from her, one of her book, Phoneme Deletion Ability, say bus without b, at 5 and 6 years, significantly predicts individual variation in reading ability at 9 years. But you notice what it's talking about here is talking about deletion, which is an advanced phonemic awareness skill. And, you know, of course, kindergarten students, we are working with the deletion with them at the phoneme level. So if your kids are having difficulty with this, it's giving you information. I always say it's a canary in the mine, right? It's that little red flag when they can't do these things, right? Which means even more so that they need direct, explicit instruction. So thank you for talking with your partners about that. So in what ways does this research align with your beliefs and practices? Does it align pretty closely with what you believe and with your practices? For the most part, when I was walking around, people were like, yes. Especially the coaches over here, they're like, yeah, we know this. So the important thing is to align our beliefs and what we know from the evidence, from research, with the empirical evidence, with our practices. Because just because we believe it doesn't mean that we do anything about it, right? And that's what really makes the difference, the doing. Right? Because I know as a teacher, oftentimes I went to a conference and I learned something and I believed it. I went back to my classroom and I did it for a little while. And then I went to a conference later and I went, oh, I used to do that. Right? So tonight we're really going to be engaged in doing, right? And you'll see that on our Patton YouTube channel that we have filmed 22 lessons of advanced phonemic awareness. And everything I'm going to teach you tonight about what I've learned about teaching phonemic awareness, I owe to teachers. I don't have the honor of being in a classroom again every day. I wish I did. I miss that. That was the happiest probably I was ever in my life with those kindergarten kids, right? But I have a lot of joy in teaching adults too, right? So we need to do it as well. And as teachers, often, that's why my doctorate was in professional learning, my PLCs were all about teachers visiting other teachers to see practice, because teaching can be so isolating. So think about what a football coach does. When they're gonna be with a rival team, they get tape, they go visit, they watch, they see every move, and they talk about the best practices of that football player. Why are we not doing that in teaching? Why are our doors closed? We learn so much from each other. So when you visit these videos, tell those teachers, hooray. How brave is it of them to allow film cameras in to show you their lessons? Because as Charlotte Danielson says, we only visit the land of distinguished as teachers. We don't live there. So even in these videos, you won't see perfection, and that is real life, right? So we learn a lot from looking at each other's practice. So I encourage you not only to believe it, but to do. All right? Here we go. So I said I'm going to talk to you very briefly about a research study that we were doing about advanced phonemic awareness. Okay? So it started out as a quality improvement study in kindergarten. Not this year, last year. And really what we were doing is like, what is the impact of direct explicit instruction in advanced phonemic awareness on kindergarten foundational literacy skills? And the place we were doing this study is a very large school district in Pennsylvania. There are 13 elementary schools. And it's a, yeah, I just heard, wow, it is a big school district. And it's such an honor to work with them. And the great thing about this school district is the perfect research site, because they have a mixture of rural, suburban, and urban. And they have these match pairs. It's like the ideal place to kind of see, right? So last year when we were just talking about their needs, they said, well, you know, we have some foundational reading problems. We know we do. So they decided to implement a curriculum that was direct explicit instruction in phonemic awareness. All right, so they implemented the Hegarty curriculum. Some of you are here talking about it. This is not the only curriculum out there. Of course, Marilyn Adams has written a wonderful curriculum called Phonemic Awareness, and there are many others. Tonight, we're going to talk about this one as one model. So in this curriculum, there are 35 weeks of phonemic awareness instruction and 8 phonemic awareness skills. Every single day, kids are engaged in phonemic awareness, direct, explicit. Because most cores, not all, but most cores smatter in. They sprinkle a little phonemic awareness here, they sprinkle a little there, but it probably only gets to the blending and segmenting level if we're lucky, right? So we need our kids engaged in advanced phonemic awareness every single day. So a little pre-K kid, that might mean I'm gonna say the word campground. You say it with me.
Campground.
Now say it without camp.
Ground.
Right? So you have deleted, you're getting used to that deletion skill, but you're using a larger language unit. Remember what I said our job is, our goal of instruction? Differentiate, progressive differentiation of the language to these sequences of sounds until we are down to that phoneme level. And then expanding that from a VC, a C, CV, CVC, and all the way out. So kids are attending to the phonemic sequence of words so that they can map that into phonological working memory in an accurate and deep way, so then they can map on those graphemes. So that's what this does. It supports. The nice thing about it, too, is in kindergarten and in the primary to the week 7, it brings back nursery rhymes. Give me a round of applause for that right now. Come on. Nursery rhymes, what happened to nursery rhymes? Right? Gosh, they're so important. And in the kindergarten curriculum, you're engaged in nursery rhymes and in the primary for the first 7 weeks. And the kids love it. There is also one phonics part where there's a card pack every day, and that card pack gets progressively difficult. It starts out in kindergarten with the letters of the alphabet in alphabetical order. The letter is A, the sound is A. The letter is B, the sound is B. All in sequence. Now, when you're in kindergarten, right, it's usually the first week of school. Who's saying most of this, teacher or kids? Teacher. So with this repetitive practice day after day after day after day after day, guess what happens? You do it with me. The letter is A, the sound is A. The letter is B. Then they start getting mixed up. Then we add blends, digraphs, vowel teams, are controlled, right? So it gets progressively more challenging. But every day they're engaged in a little bit of phonics where they're mapping grapheme to phoneme. So 8 skills every day in phonemic awareness, 1 skill in language awareness that goes away week 7 in the primary, and then the card pack every day, all right? So these are the skills that I just spoke about. Alphabet, rhyming, onset fluency. And then you notice in yellow, we blend at the word, syllable, onset, rhyme, phoneme. Segment, word, syllable, onset, rhyme, phoneme. Do you see a pattern there? We're going from larger language units to smaller language units, right? Okay, so blending, identifying final or medial sounds, segmenting, substituting, adding, deleting, and that language awareness is the nursery rhymes. All right, and then here we have at your tables, you have the blue and yellow books. The blue book is the kindergarten book, the purple book is the pre-K book, and the yellow book is the primary, which is for grades 1 and 2. All right, so in the school district, as I said, it's a very large school district. There are some demographics for you to see. 19 schools in total, 13 elementary schools. We have 49% roughly that are white. We have 13.9% who are Hispanic, and 20% are black. All right, so that's a little bit of information about the school district, Central Dolphin School District in central Pennsylvania. All right, and then you can see there's gaps between title schools and non-title schools, right? We often see this where kids, if they're low SES, unfortunately, sometimes you see a pattern of lower performance in low SES schools or title schools compared to their wealthier SES schools. So the goal, of course, always is equity, social justice. Our children, every child deserves to learn how to read. If we believe this, we have the responsibility to learn how to teach it, right? So here are the schools. You can see there's like just about a 30% gap here, 25% gap here, and then maybe about maybe a little bit less than 20 there, or more than 20. Okay, so what the district did is they partnered with Patton, and of course the goal was to build a stronger literacy foundation. They didn't really have the outcomes that they wanted. They implemented this curriculum, and then I've been working with them now for four full years. And what I've been doing with the focus schools that I work with is meeting with them every single month for 3 hours and going deeper into the science of reading. And every single month, we visit each other's classrooms to see lessons. So in the morning, I have 20 first grade teachers and reading specialists, and we all go into the classrooms and watch a teacher. And then we debrief on that and we say, wow, that was really great. And you know what I see happen? Teacher A last month did something great about rhyming, which I'm gonna tell you in a little bit. And then next month, when we go to visit the other school, guess who's doing it? The other teachers, teacher B. Did I tell teacher A you should do it that way, yes or no? No, I would never do that. That is the art of teaching. I'm not trying to take that away. And the teacher's teaching that way because she's differentiating because of her students, right? That's what she should be doing. But I start seeing all of these great practices spreading around. That's what we want, right? So they have ongoing support. So this is a Lynn Stone quote. She has a new book out, which is absolutely excellent. We're all gonna read this together, ready? The mark of a good teacher or system is the output of their bottom students, not their top ones, right? So let's look at what happened at Central Dolphin. Okay, here is their first sound fluency at the beginning of the year. Their schools that are in yellow are their title schools, and the schools that are not are their non-title schools. What do you see about those numbers to the right? They're pretty darn good. They're outpacing the non-title schools. Okay, that's in the first year of implementation where we expect an implementation dip. The research talks about an implementation dip the first year you implement. So this was from September to January, right? So look at the scores over here. We are keeping pace with our non-title schools and in some cases surpassing those. School 11 and 12 are the poorest schools in the district. Very, very, very poor school, poor SES. And look at how much improvement they've had. All right, so let's look at PSF, and they said, oh, we're really sad that they didn't test PSF and Dibbles at the beginning of the year, because by January, our kids knew so much about PSF, we would have loved to see how much they had grown from the beginning of the school year. But again, 29, 19, 13, minus 5, plus 2, plus 2, plus 11, plus 14, plus 2, plus 29, plus 19, plus 30. And that's in PSF. So they were pretty happy, right? They should have been. They worked really hard. The teachers worked really hard. The reading specialists worked very hard. So they said, okay, so we can't say that this is a direct result of our instruction. So let's see if we can see if it is. So this year, what we're doing is a true research study in advanced phonemic awareness. What we're trying to find out is, if you teach advanced phonemic awareness every single day in first grade, do you see better outcomes in nonsense word fluency, PSF, and ORF? So those things that are close to the skills, but then are they able to transfer those skills into connected text? And we have university partners. Mike Coyne, very well-respected researcher at the University of Connecticut, and Lena Edwards-Centoro as well. So, as I said, they have 13 elementary schools, so 7 schools are in treatment, 6 are in control, which means they're doing business as usual. It doesn't mean they can't teach phonemic awareness. They can't teach it with this curriculum in particular, but they can still teach it. So we're going to be looking to see what happens. So we're at 7 in treatment, 6 in control, and then they have matched pairs. So that's what's great about that district. You can match a really poor school with another really poor school that's not doing it. All right, so this is what we're trying to find out. And these are the measures we're using. I want to tell you, the Hegarty assessment, when we first looked at it, was not standardized. It didn't have discontinue rules. It didn't have ways if kids responded correctly to give them feedback. All those standard things that you want in a standard measure. I want to give kudos right now to the reading specialists in Central Dauphin who work with me to standardize those assessments. So that was a year's worth of labor and love. So I'll share those with Maria so she can share them with you. But we really worked to standardize that measure so we would look at Dibbles. And really when we think of Hegarty, it's a curriculum-based measure. We're putting in a curriculum, we're looking at how it's going along, right? And then we did, and last year as well, a knowledge survey of teachers. How much do they know now about phonemic awareness? And can we say most of our higher ed is teaching phonemic awareness in an evidence-based way, yes or no? No, they are not. And it was reflected deeply in those pre-assessments from teachers who have been teaching 1 year to teachers who have been teaching more than 20 years. So it helped me help them when I'm doing the PLCs to know how I can know their strengths and their areas of need. So we're going to look at that post-assessment, and hopefully the teachers who came to my PLC would do better than the teachers who didn't. So we'll see. And then, of course, a teacher survey. The teachers are filling out logs about implementation, you know, daily logs. And then we're looking at demographics as well. So these are fidelity measures. As I said, the daily log, treatment and control, monthly PLCs. And that's pretty much it. Okay, so is this typically what you see? Those outcomes that we saw for FSF and PSF, is that growth and achievement, is that what you're seeing in your schools? Turn and talk to your partner for one, I'm gonna put you on the clock for 1 minute. Thank you from the back. You are the best table, zero noise signals. Thank you. Okay, so I'll let you keep those conversations private. But I think those are the kind of outcomes we want all kids to experience. And of course, they're not resting on their laurels back there. They are continuing to work very hard because they want those numbers to be 100%, right? Right, we want 100%. All right, so here's what I want to tell you. I know some of you in here are already engaged in the curriculum. I want to tell you about some things we've learned along the way. So this is to really help your implementation of any curriculum that's related to phonemic awareness, all right? Okay, repeat after me. Everybody ready? There is no magic bullet. There is no magic bullet. There is no magic bullet. I know in education we want it. We're like, oh, that's the magic bullet. There is no magic bullet. I would say the only thing that attempts to being a magic bullet is a teacher who has the knowledge of language to teach kids. That's the closest we can get. Because as Louise says, let's do this together, teachers teach kids, not programs. All right? So it's all about expert teaching. Remember I said with my grandkids, I want them seeing my mouth, and especially my little Leo. I have to say, look at Nana's mouth, look at Nana's mouth, look at Nana's mouth. Is your voice box on, right? Because it helps him, right? And when kids, here's what and Louisa Moat says, and it's so true. Phonemes are sounds, of course, but they're also articulatory gestures. And kids feel them, right? So it's the expert teacher that makes the difference. But as this slide says, we would never say that so you go back and you become just an expert in phonemic awareness and your kids are knocking it out of the park. Does that guarantee they're going to be great readers? No, it's only one component, right? So here we are with phonology, but look at the systems of language, right? We have orthography, our writing system, morphology, the study of meaningful units. Like when I was in kindergarten, I'd say cat, there's one morpheme, cats. Oh, we've got two, it means more than one, two meaningful units there. Semantics, vocabulary, syntax, our grammar and sentence structure, discourse, and pragmatics, right? So reading and writing depend on language. If you know this, then you'll become a teacher of language, not just a teacher of reading and writing. So what I'm saying tonight is I encourage you, become, if you're not already, a teacher of language, right? Okay, so what we learned, I almost want to say what this is, duh, right? But one of the things we really learned was teacher knowledge of the speech sounds of the English language, how to articulate them accurately and teach them to students directly and specifically is essential. If you don't know how to teach the speech sounds yet, that's something you really need to be able to do with kids, right? So I'm sure you probably have seen this before. If you're letters, these are the consonant sounds of our English language by place and manner of articulation. So that means is the sound made at the front, back, or middle of the mouth, and how are we making that sound? All right, so let's look at the first, a stop sound when we put our lips together. All right, so we're all gonna make the sound for P. Everybody ready? Turn to your neighbor and make it. Put your hand out here. What do you feel? A quick puff of air, yes. And does the air go on and on and on and on and on, or does it stop? It's a stop sound. Now let's make the sound for B. Everybody ready? Thank you. You didn't say ba and schwa. Thank you. Ba. All right, and then put your voice, hand right here in your throat. Ready? Ba. Turn to your neighbor or your partner and do that. Ba. Ah. So see, our lips, teeth, tongue, we're all doing the same thing, but in one, our voice box is turned off, and in one, it's turned on. So these stops have these pairs that are voiced and unvoiced. Stops or continuance. Let's make the sound for M, everybody. What's it say? Lips together. Ready? Hold your nose. Can you make it? No. It's a nasal sound. The airflow is coming through our nose. So that's a and a and a They're all nasal sounds that come through our nose. Then we have our fricatives with some friction. Ready? Let's make the sound for the F. Oh, I don't even know if I can say that. You know what I mean. Let's do it. All right, and now let's make the sound for V. What's the only difference? Our voicing, right? So these have, and they have some friction. All right, so we have our affricates. Say with me, ch, and j, ch, and j. Okay, so a little bit of friction and a little bit of stop. And then we have our glides and our liquids that glide into the phonemes around them. All right, so here's the thing. If you're a teacher of language, you should have one of these up in your room. Because if you have a word wall, okay, so let me tell you. Okay, so I tell my kids in kindergarten, this is the letter S, it says, and on my word wall I have the word she. Where do kids begin when they're gonna encode, when they're gonna write? So they're at their little table, they're trying to write the word she. Where do they begin? They begin with speech. They start going shh. Oh gosh, there's no shh up there. Oh, I think we're missing some phonemes, huh? Right, so very confusing for kids. Word walls are from the learner point of view, the person who already knows the orthography and phonology of words. And our kids begin with speech. So we want to shift to sound walls. So what I'm telling you is, that's what our teachers did. Here's our vowel valley, watch my mouth. E, I, A, E, A, I, A. What'd you see, right? So our kids, these vowels that are close together, say E and E with me, right? E and I. E, I. Turn to your partner and do it. E, I. Much difference? No. But if you had a mirror for every child, right? Let's see if I can get this open. I don't know, how do you do that? then kids can see the difference. Because oftentimes they'll spell these things wrong. They'll spell P as pit or pit as Pete, right? So also if you're a teacher of language, you need little mirrors, right? You need little mirrors. And mouth pictures. Kid lips, these are from Mary Dobbins Tools for Reading, right? So having the mouths up. Now I know when I was teaching, and Mary says this too, certainly you could have your own kids do this, right? Because my kids love saying like, oh, well, I'm the mm, or she's the mm, right? It gave a lot of ownership, but these are very well done, right? And of course we need sound spelling cards. Also from your dog, and they're awesome, okay? So I just showed you some resources that can help you. Again, of course, you could do those on your own, those mouth pictures. Tonight, part of your homework is going to be go to the app, the Orton-Gillingham card deck. It's a free download. It tells you the name, sound, a keyword, and then it shows you how to make the sound. The Orton-Gillingham card deck, and I just showed you also, if you're going to be teaching phonemic awareness, you need to have little mirrors for your kids. I know one of the kindergarten teachers I work with, she has her sound wall, and bolted next to it, she has, you know when you go to college and you get those tall mirrors? You know, you can get them cheap at Walmart. She has that bolted right there, so the kids come up and they go, oh, Papa. They use the mirror, they look at the sound wall, they go back and write. Okay? I'm not going to take you here just in terms of time, but I'm sure many of you are familiar with Spelfabet, and they have an excellent video that shows you how to make the speech sounds of language. Okay? So the title of the blog is Phonemes or Sounds and Articulatory Gestures. If you Google it, it'll come right up. And then Literacy How, Margie Gillis's website, which is absolutely awesome, also has a YouTube video to show you how to make the speech sounds. So often what I'll say to my teachers and principals is, okay, so you're starting a faculty meeting. This is about 3 minutes. We're all going to practice making our speech sounds. Because I'm here to tell you, schwa happens. Say it with me. Schwa happens. And when schwa happens, bad things happen to writing. Okay, so let's say it's easy to do. I'm telling you, I do it. I am confessing that I do it. It happens at times. It's easy to do, but I'm going to ask you to be careful to clip your sounds. So you'll hear maybe a teacher say, for T, she'll say ta. Ta. So maybe the child goes and writes top, and they write T, U, O, P, and the teacher's like, why in the world is that U in there? Because, right? What you hear, these are related. Phonology and orthography are interdependent. They're reciprocal relationships. So if you are schwaing, your kids are going to schwa. If your kids schwa, when you go back, if your kids schwa, you go, oh yeah, I must be schwaing. They're schwaing. I must have modeled it, right? So you can say, oh gosh, kids, I've been schwaing. Oh, it's just terrible. Guess what we're going to do? We're going to use this little signal. It means they're going to clip our sounds, right? And here is Stephanie McClune's sound wall. She is one of the first grade teachers that I had the honor of working with. So we did one of our PLCs was on sound walls. And so right away she went back and applied it in her classroom. And so what I thought was really cool that she did, which is I love what teachers do. She did this, what? This is green and this is red. Why do you think they're green and red? Voiced, unvoiced. Voiced, unvoiced. Isn't she brilliant? Don't you love learning from teachers? She's awesome. All right, and then you see what do you see here too? Those are her kids' mouths making those sounds. And then here's her vowel valley. And those are her children. So she's learning about phonemic awareness, but she knows in order to be a skilled teacher, it is her responsibility to teach the speech sounds. So she shifted her word wall in the middle of the year to a sound wall, both the consonant chart and the vowel valley, okay? All right, so the other thing we learned, of course, is that we want to have kids actively engaged, which means multimodal. We want them engaged by language, by ear, by eye, by mouth, and by hand. That's Virginia Berninger. Okay, so it's talking about consistent hand motions and language. Here's the thing with teachers, and I am also at fault here. We talk too much. We talk too much. We like to talk, right? But when we're instructing, we want clear, concise language. so that kids can focus on the skill. And also, we want that language to be consistent from the para to the core teacher to the interventionist. Anyone who works with that child should be using the same routines in the same language. Because who gets the most variance in instruction? Kids who are reading typically or those who are not typical? Not typical. Gosh, we make it so hard for them. They're trying to learn these skills, and I'm one teacher A is saying it this way, teacher B is saying it that way, and they're like, oh my God, like, okay, I have to remember she calls it this, they call it that, she does it this way, they do it that way. Consistent language and instructional methodologies, routines is essential. All right, I'm gonna be teaching you hand motions tonight. You do not have to do the same hand motions that I do, but if you are using hand motions, you all decide and you all do them the same way. You can do anything you want. Like I was in a classroom last week, another school I had the honor of working with for onset fluency, there wasn't a hand motion, they made one up. They said, let's just do cat, say cat. And they're gonna go, k, at. They pinch the initial sound for the kids, and then they show this larger language unit. That's fine with me, as long as they're all doing it the same way. I am not the hand motion police, right? But I do think it's essential that you all be doing it the same way, all right? So there is a video. I told you at the Patton YouTube channel, and I put a direct link. Oh, I thought I did. I put a tiny URL. But we have 22 lessons. 22 lessons and a quick pick that's done by Andrew Bell, who's one of our literacy consultants in the Patton East. That is outstanding. So if you are a coach or a principal responsible for teaching about advanced phonemic awareness, why not use the quick pick that Andrew Bell did? It's absolutely awesome, right? And then you have lots of videos too. There they are, there's that tiny URL. Just today, we filmed 5 more lessons. We have 3 more kindergarten lessons going up next week and 2 more first grade lessons going up, all right? Okay, so what are your thoughts on our lessons learned? Turn only for 30 seconds. What do you think about what we learned? Teaching the speech sounds of the English language, making sure language is consistent between all those who are students, using multimodal practices. You have 30 seconds to talk to your partner, then I'm bringing you back. Bring you back. Okay, thank you. Thank you, my friends in the back too. You guys need a prize. You guys are the first. Thank you. Okay. All right. So instruction and implementation, we're gonna get right into the lessons now and we're gonna be modeling them. The lessons take about 10 to 12 minutes a day to do. And I always say, are our children worth 10 to 12 minutes, yes or no? Yes, they are. They're worth a whole lot more than that, but they're certainly worth 10 to 12 minutes a day to get those foundational skills, right? Again, I talked to you about these skills earlier. Okay, so we're gonna see a video of Stephanie McClune doing a lesson. What I'm not gonna show you is the card pack and the rhyming from that lesson, because I wanna talk to you about them a little bit, because you're not gonna see the full breadth. Okay, so here's what I wanna say about the card pack. If you are using an alphabet card pack, Mary Dahlgren has a great one. Foundations has a great one. What I mean by what makes them great is they all actually make the sound of the letter. Because I was in a classroom last year and I thought I was gonna have a coronary. Guess what was up there for X? Xylophone, say xylophone. Oh my gosh. Ah! So if you have foundation cards, you can be assured that the Q actually makes the sound, right? If you have Mary Dahlgren's, you could also be certain that it makes the sound, right? Now, here's one. We're just going to go through one pack, and you're going to tell me what's a keep and a throwaway. And we're going to do it as I would if I was teaching. The letter is A, the sound is A. Keep it. The letter is B, the sound is B. Just give me a thumbs up or thumbs down real quick. The letter is C, the sound is K. The letter is D, the sound is D. The letter is E, the sound is E. Say elephant. Oh, elephant. What do you hear? L. It's a glide. Oh, what about ed? The letter is E, the sound is, or the word is ed, right? If the ed was a Q there. Or edge, as in Mary's. All right, the letter is F, the sound is F. Yes? The letter is G, the sound is G. The letter is H, the sound is H. The letter is I, the sound is I. Say igloo. Oh, what do you hear? E. Say igloo to your partner. Igloo. Oh. What about I, itch? Yeah? Okay. The letter is J, the sound is J. The letter is K, the sound is K. The letter is L, the sound is O. The letter is M, the sound is M. The letter is N, the sound is M. The letter is O, the sound is ah. The letter is P, the sound is P. The letter is Q, the sound is Qu. The letter is R, the sound is R. The letter is S, the sound is S. The letter is T, the sound is T. The letter is U, the sound is U. Umbrella, say it with me. Hold your nose. Uh-oh. What's happened? It's become what? Nasalized, right? It's become nasalized, not a good one. The letter is V, the sound is V. The letter is W, the sound is W. The letter is X, the sound is X. The letter is Y, the sound is Y. The letter is Z, the sound is Z. So just a couple there. So here's what I want to say to you. Go back. If you are using a poster or alphabet cue cards, your job is to go back tomorrow and see if those cue cards actually make the sound. If they don't, guess what you have to do? Chuck it. Throw it away and get another one. Yes. What's that? Oh, sometimes it's Q and U. This is from, yeah, it should be. And that's another thing you'd want. Yeah, you're right about that. These come from LRI. They're pretty good. There's just a couple there. And there are lowercase ones. They have egg and grass. All right, so ready? I'm going to bring you back. Your card pack starts with alphabet letters. And as I said, who's making most of the sounds? The teacher, until the kids pick it up. Then you're eventually going to bring in digraphs and blends. Oh, it's getting tricky now. Here's what I learned from teachers last year, and I learned from watching so many. They were saying, ready? The letters are CH, the sound is CH. The letters are CH, the sound is CH. All right, that's fine. Then they've got to some blends. Ready? The letters are SL, the sound is. So what's wrong with that prompt? The sounds are. Blends are two sounds. So if you're doing a card pack with digraphs or blends, no problem saying the sound is with a digraph, but when you're in blends, you better be saying the sounds are. That little itty bitty things matter. Because what's gonna happen is children are gonna unitize this, treat it as a digraph, and then when they go to write it, uh-oh, right? So another way I've seen teachers use it, which I think is a brilliant, like I said, I always learn so much from teachers, and this is from first grade teacher Kathy Hassman at Blue Mountain School District. She just does this. Ready? The letters are WH, digraph. And runs her finger underneath there. She doesn't even leave it up for letters are WH, digraph. That's it. Letters are SL, blend. Right? So you decide how to do it, but you want to make sure that you are using the correct language, right? Eventually you're saying both sounds of the vowels, the letter is A, the sound is A and A. The letter is E, the sound is E and E. The letter is G, the sound is G and J. The letter is C, the sound is K and S. So the card pack progressively gets more difficult and challenging. But the kids, right, they just start joining in. So here's what we know about teaching. We want to scaffold a lot of teacher voice when we're starting that skill. When your kids' voices are strong, what do you need to do as a teacher? Back off. Fade that scaffold. So we would just say, letters are, blend. We're not doing anything. I'm letting my students do everything. And then I might just do a card pack for accuracy. Letters, sound. Letters, sound. Letters, sound. Letters, sound. We want to be scaffolding our students strongly when they're learning a new skill, but I know as teachers, and I'm guilty of this, we often don't take the scaffolds away. We need to take them away so they're independent, right? So that's just some things to know about the card pack that you wouldn't know. Another thing is, I had a concern in the blue book about the letter cheer. And I heard some laughter out there. Because here's what would happen. The teacher would just show, let's just say, let me do this quickly. All right, the kids would say, T-H-E the, ready? T-H-E the. What am I communicating to kids? That learning to read is a visual memory process. Now, if I taught these sounds and I had taught the TH voice and said, oh, this is the word you have to, part you have to learn by heart, I don't have a problem with practicing letters or words this way. But I'm divorcing it from the phonology and the phonemic awareness that I've taught them. And so they have taken, in the new edition, they have taken the letter cheer out. Because there can just be so much misconception. And we don't want to be flashing cards at kids and pretending that that is reading. We fool ourselves that way. And then they get to third grade and we say, gosh, I can't figure out. They were doing so well. They never learned the code. And whose fault was it? It was our fault. We taught them to memorize. And our kids with high oral language who are good memorizers and good vocabulary, those are our compensators. They hide for a long time. And then there they are in third grade. And what do we know about intervention? Early. And we have just hidden a problem. All right, so make the speech sounds correctly. Look at your cards. Make sure if you're cueing, the cue cards are right. Keep the scaffolds there as long as they're needed. And immediately when they're not, fade them away. All right, so that's what I want to say about the alphabet card pack. All right, and then rhyming. Okay, so here's what I'm hearing all across the state. I wonder if it's happening in New York. The kids are having a terrible time producing rhyming words. Is that happening in New York? Yes. Yes, that's back to that nursery rhymes never happening. But also, producing a rhyming word is very hard. You have to have it in your phonological and semantic lexicon. And let's think about if I said man and asked you to give me a rhyming word, just someone to say, what have you done there? You have substituted. You are deleting, right? You're deleting, you're isolating, deleting, segmenting, adding, right? You're all the way up to substitution. So I'm here to tell you that rhyming is hard for kids. It starts out with just hearing rhyming words, and the kids do thumbs up or thumbs down. So let's just do one, and you're gonna give me a thumbs up or a thumbs down. Are you ready? My words are, and you're gonna repeat, Matt Cat.
Matt Cat.
Okay, so here's what I wanna tell you about the signal. You want it very private, or very visible. Why? Because I want to formatively assess. And if my kids are like doing all this, do I know who knows and who doesn't know, yes or no? No. So you want a very private or very public. So one of my first grade teachers makes the kids, let's just try one. Run fun.
Run, fun.
She makes them, all right, so put your arms out like this. Run fun.
Run, fun.
Okay, then put it back. Man fast. See, she's making them go back to neutral, and she's making it very public, and the other one's making it very private. But the goal is the same, formative assessment. In the blue book, in kindergarten, almost always, teacher says, students repeat. Teacher says, students repeat. Teacher says, students repeat. There are 10 prompts for each skill. Here's what I saw last year when we were still learning. Teacher says, students repeat. Teacher says, students repeat. Teacher says, students repeat. Teacher says, teacher says, teacher says, teacher says, teacher says, teacher says, teacher says. They just start dropping the students repeat. They just, right? What happens to students? Everything starts falling apart. But when you're teaching sometimes, you don't know, you don't see that. That is the value of videotaping yourself. I was a National Board Certified teacher. You have to videotape yourself. It's torture. But you learn so much, right? And that's what they're learning from seeing each other. They started to see, like, oh, she didn't have the kids repeat, and all of a sudden. So guess what started happening by November? Teacher says, students repeat. Teacher says, students repeat. Teacher says, students repeat. It stopped happening. So if it says, teacher says, students repeat, that means for every single prompt. Okay? All right. Also with rhyming, you start getting these rhyming sequences where kids have to hold on to a lot of oral language. It's hard on working memory. So they might have the words like lawn, cat, fawn. Do it with me. Lawn, cat, fawn. And they have to say the two that rhyme. Lawn, fawn. But there's no hand motion for that. So what I'm saying is you probably have to add on something, because holding all that language, that working memory, is really hard. All right, so I'm going to do one more thing. Give me a word that rhymes with sat. Nice lady in the green. Cat. Okay, there's probably about 200 of you in here. Guess what? While she was giving the answer, 199 of you were like, You were having a little bird walk, right? You didn't have to. Were you on the hot seat for learning, yes or no? No. So another thing I'm going to tell you is, if you are asking kids to produce a rhyming word, she said sat. Everybody? Okay, do that again. Okay, give me a word that rhymes with sat. Everybody? What did you say? Fat. Everybody? Oh, now you're required to listen. Listen. You have to be cognitively engaged. And you have to respond. Do you see how that ratchets up the demand in the classroom for cognitive engagement? Just from a little bit, oh, choral response. Also, if I'm asking kids to produce a rhyming word, I say, tell them to turn and talk first. They need that oral scaffold. Producing a rhyming word is so hard. You want them to turn and talk, and then you can listen in too, right? So these are all ways you can ramp up rhyming to really amplify the results you're getting for kids. And if we just seen the rhyming from Stephanie, we wouldn't have seen the breadth of that, okay? All right, so again, this is the ladder. You can see word, syllable, onset rhyme, phoneme, and then you can see the weeks. Again, purple is pre-K. If you have pre-K classrooms, I strongly encourage you to be engaged in phonemic awareness with those classrooms. Your kindergarten kids will come in much stronger, and you'll identify kids much sooner who might need support. So purple is pre-K, blue is kindergarten, yellow is primary, which means first and second. If you're implementing for the first year and K-1-2 is doing it, second grade begins with week one. If you've been doing it K-1-2, they begin with week 15. Kind of see how the kids did over the summer and are they okay to start here. But then you go weeks 15 to week 35. And if it's a Monday, it's always a Monday lesson. If it's a Tuesday, it's always a Tuesday lesson. Because I'm sure, like you, you have lots of snow days, yes? And it can get really confusing about where you are. So you stay, if the kids miss a day or two, it's not that big of a deal. It's a cumulative curriculum. So you'll see, even in the video that you're going to see, that they're doing some earlier phonological and phonemic awareness skills, and you're thinking, gosh, they're in first grade. That's because it brings these things back, and any good curriculum does, because we want to make sure that the skills are secure, right? Distributed and cumulative practice is a hallmark of a good curriculum. All right. Okay, so this is what Heidi and I were talking about a little bit when she called me when I sent her the PowerPoint. We talked about phonemic proficiency. Say that with me. Phonemic proficiency. Accurate, automatic, unconscious awareness. Where kids are so aware, they're unaware. So let me give you an example. Say cat. Cat. Change ah to ah, and my word is ah. Ah. Did you have to think about that? All right, so what did you have to do for go from cat to cot? First thing you had to do what? Segment the word to figure out where that change was. Then you had to do what? Isolate the sound, delete the sound, add the sound, blend the sound. Did you think of any of that? No. So that's why Dave says it's so important to teach advanced phonemic awareness. If you can do that, can you segment, yes or no? Can you add? Can you delete? Can you blend? Are you unconsciously aware of it? Yes. Accuracy first, proficiency next, and then this unconscious awareness of the speech sounds of our language, so that we don't even need to think about them. Then we map them to the graphemes and letter patterns. So in letters, we talk about, Carol Tolman talks about Gordon's ladder of competency. So here we have the lack of awareness stage, your unconscious incompetence. You don't know what you don't know, right? You ever been there? I've been there. You don't know what you don't know, right? And then you go like, okay, uh-oh, I don't know. All of a sudden you realize you don't know something, but you're still not skilled, right? And then conscious competence, oh, you know and you're skilled. And then this is where we want to be getting our kids, unconscious competencies. You're so skilled you don't need to think about it. Okay, so think about when you learn to drive. I can still see myself with stick shift on a hill. My dad's beside me. I started out with like, oh my God, what is the clutch? What do I have to do? Where's the gas pedal? Right? I was unconsciously incompetent. And then he was like teaching me these things, but I was still learning. I was conscious of what I needed to know and be able to do, but I was still incompetent. And then the first time I was on that hill, and then who drives stick, right? Aren't you scared? When someone would pull up behind me, I'd be like, oh my God, 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 don't let me hit the car, right? But I was consciously then competent. Oh, I did it, yay. All right, but have you ever had the experience that you drove somewhere and you got there and you don't even know how you got there? Yes or no?
Yes.
All right, so what are you? You're unconsciously competent. You have automatized all those skills. You don't even need to think about it anymore. Any skill you learn goes through this process, right? So first we want kids accurate and automatic with those skills so they become phonemically proficient. And then so aware, as Heidi says, that they're unaware. And that's what advanced phonemic awareness does. All right, so let's look at a lesson. This is Stephanie McClune. She is a first grade teacher at Northside Elementary at Central Dauphin School District. I can honestly tell you I could have picked any one of the 22 videos. And so this is her lesson. You have this lesson in your handouts. You can follow along. As I told you, since I kind of gave you those hints on the alphabet pack and the rhyming, you won't see that, but it's going to start with onset fluency. And we're going to pray that the technology gods are in our favor. Okay, so it's the white paper, I believe. It's week 22. All right, I'm pretty sure it's the white one, correct? Yes, it is. That's the primary. So this is Stephanie McClune and her students. Are you ready to watch? Now follow along and make any notes if you want to, you know, talk about it afterwards. All right? All right. So here we go.
Excellent. All right, boys and girls. I am going to give you a word. You tell me the first sound we hear. Swift.
Swift.
Place.
Place.
Gleam.
Gleam.
Good. Blow.
Blow.
Store.
Store.
Fling.
Fling.
Smooth.
Smooth.
Trace.
Trace.
Drill.
Drill.
Crane.
Crane.
What a good job. 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 All right, I'm gonna chop it up. You blend it together. G-O-A-N-S.
Glance.
B-R-A-N-S.
Bronze.
T-W-I-N.
Twin.
P-O-A-N.
Plump.
D-R-S.
Dress.
C-O-A-N-P.
Glamp.
Shift.
Shift.
Prank.
Prank.
Eat.
Fleet.
That was fantastic. All right, I'm giving you three words. You're gonna punch out the end sound. Here we go. Sleeve, have, live. Rich, such, lunch. Team, rhyme, came. Miss, pass. Cups. Drop, lap, slip. Oh, listen again. Drop, slap, drop, lap, slip. If, off, tough. Lick, sack, make. Cloth, path, both. Swish, push, cash. All right, warm them up. All right, chop up your word. Plenty.
O-N-T-E.
Change.
A-N-G.
Throat.
Throat.
Crust.
Crust.
Drift.
Drift.
Sleek.
Sleek.
Branch.
Branch.
Chuckle.
Chuckle.
Frosty.
Frosty.
Excellent job, boys and girls. You can dab that one. All right, get your little roller coasters. Chose.
Chose.
Change O to E.
Cheese. Cheese.
Is that a long or short E?
Long.
Good. Sneak.
Sneak.
Change E to A.
Snake.
Snake. Is that a long or short A?
Long.
A long one. Nice. Spike.
Spike.
Change I to O.
Spoke.
Spoke. Is that a long or short O?
Long.
Swim.
Swim.
Change it to a.
Swim.
Swam. Nice. Is that a long or short A?
Short.
You guys are so smart. Past.
Past.
Change a to off.
Ost. Past.
That doesn't sound right, does it? It's because Mrs. McClune goofed up. Try it again. Past.
Past.
Change a to o.
Ost. Post.
Good job. Is that a long or short O?
Long.
Good job. Green.
E-N.
Change E to I.
E-N.
Grin. Is that a long or short I?
Short.
Shape.
Shape.
Change A to E.
Sheep.
Sheep. Long or short E?
Long.
Trick.
Trick.
Change it to U.
Truck.
Truck. Is that a long or short U?
Short.
Braid.
Braid.
Change A to I.
Braid.
Bride. Long or short I?
Long.
Bride. Do you hear I?
Long.
It's a long one. You're right. Band.
Band.
Change A to E.
Band.
Bend. Nice job. Is that long or short E?
Short.
Short E. Very good. Give me some fireworks for that. All right, friends, I'm going to give you the first sound, then I'm going to give you the rest of the word. Repeat the first sound, okay? Then we'll put the whole word together. Buh. Add O to the end, and the word is
old.
Add ask to the end, and the word is
ass.
Duh. Add ice to the end, and the word is
ice.
Mm. Add eat to the end, and the word is
eat.
Add own to the end, and the word is
own.
Add ear to the end, and the word is
ear.
Good.
Good.
Add eight to the end, and the word is
eight.
Add each to the end, and the word is
each.
Add I to the end, and the word is
I.
Whoa.
Whoa.
Add all to the end, and the word is ooh, roller coaster.
Woo!
All right, last part, friends. I'm gonna give you the whole word. We're gonna take away the end. You tell me what's left. Pitch.
Pitch.
Without itch, what's left? Mourn.
Mourn.
Without or, what's left?
Mm.
Light.
Light.
Without ight, what's left?
Ooh.
Take.
Take.
Without ache, what's left? Sing.
Sing.
Without ing, what's left? Goat.
Goat.
Without oat, what's left?
Goat.
Car.
Car.
Without r, what's left? Dance.
Dance.
Without ants, what's left?
Gem.
Gem. Without M, what's left?
Gem.
Known.
Known.
Without own, what's left?
Mm.
Good job. I'm good stuff.
I'm good stuff.
You're good stuff too.
You're good stuff too.
Good job, boys and girls. Give yourself a round of applause.
All right. I
I will say that the other 21 are as good as that one. They really are. One time when I was showing the video, someone said like, oh, is that like celebration part of Haggerty? And I was like, no, that's just part of good teaching. Right? We want to give our kids feedback and have these little mini celebrations. Do you see how the pace was nice and perky? No downtime to like get in trouble with my neighbor, right? So I'm going to give you 30 seconds on my clock just to talk to your table or your partner about this video. We're going to debrief for a couple minutes, but then we're going to get right into us doing it together, okay? So you're on the clock for 30 seconds for talking. All right, so thank you. Anyone want to just share out loud and proud? Anyone want to share out loud and proud? So we're just going to bring you back to zero noise first. Okay, so you'll have to stand up and be nice and loud. Yes. Yes, stand. Yeah, consistent language and just exactly as it should be. Anyone else want to give Stephanie a glow? Yes. Yeah. She had great intensity, perky pace, right? Kids are getting really skilled at it, right? That's what we want. Are they moving towards unconscious competence? They are. I think right now they're consciously competent, but I think they're moving to where we want them to be. Anything else anyone wants to say about that lesson other than it was, yes? Yeah, so she made a mistake, you know, and you know what I also liked? Guess what other language system they were using? I said, oh, that doesn't sound right. Right? That's not a word in our lexicon, our semantic lexicon past, right? So they knew right away they were using semantics as well to figure out, well, this just isn't working. And did somebody over there have their hand raised? I thought, I just don't want to lose anybody. The other thing a friend brought up, and I would show us what a skilled group you are, is the affrication of drift when it says drift, right? That affrication, and also with the TR when they said sh. Right? That's an affrication of those sounds. So they do make those sounds. There's nothing wrong with the students making those sounds. But we know that, so there we're going to be marrying the phonology and the orthography, that our mouth is saying shh, but it's because of the affrication. And for Stephanie, you wouldn't do that during a lesson. You're not going to stop and talk about affrication. But because she's been coming to PLCs and stuff, she knows all about that. She can do that later. Oh, did you see how your mouth did that? It's getting ready for that rip sound. And so we have these affrications. Okay? So that was Stephanie's lesson. So I think it was pretty awesome, but I will tell you the other ones are really good too. And they're also really like real teaching, not perfect, right? I'm not perfect, you're not perfect, nobody's perfect. But I really, at the end I have thank you slides and I have every single one of their names because I am deeply indebted to them. Not only for sharing their practice with the world, some of those, Mary Feaster is a kindergarten teacher who I showed a lot of her stuff last year. She's had over 2,000 views of her. Think about that. She put herself out there for 2,000 people looking at her practice. I bow down to them, and I'm so honored to work with them. Okay, so we talked about early phonological awareness, the rhyming, the alliterations. Here's the only thing I'm going to tell you as a caution. When you're looking at onset fluency, where kids are listening for the first sound, the initial sound in an onset rhyme, sometimes the prompts are nasalized or are controlled. And here's the thing, I told my teachers, well, I cross that out, put in another one. Why would I want to say am and ask my kids to say ah? It got nasalized. I always say teachers are smarter when they're programmed. When they know how to teach language, you have the permission to cross that out and put in a word like at. Can you hear ah much better than am or art? So please look at whatever curriculum you're using. If the onset fluency is co-articulating a nasal or R controlled, especially when kids are learning the sounds, guess what you need to do? Chuck it. That's gonna be maybe that's my word for tonight, chuck it. Okay, so these are the things I was talking to you about earlier, about rhyming. And most important, I guess I'm gonna be say this again and again, clip your sounds. So not in Stephanie's video, but many of the videos you'll actually see the teachers doing this. The letter is T, the sound is T, and the kids are doing it too. They know that they could schwa. So schwa happens, but it shouldn't, okay? All right, so now we're gonna be looking at basic phonemic awareness. That's about blending, segmenting, and the isolation of the medial and final sounds of a word, okay? A spoken word. All right, so we're gonna talk about blending. So we know, of course, blending is when sounds are joined together. And it's critically important for reading because as kids are coming to print and they're seeing speech, you're bringing their speech sounds to it and they need to blend it accurately, automatically, and very quickly, right? And we want kids unitizing, right? And that's what happens when they get all this experience with phonology and phonemic awareness and many repeated exposures with print as well, all right? It's a very critical skill for basic phonemic awareness. You will see, too, that in some curriculums, they're using El Conan boxes. When we came to this in the instruction, the teachers are like, oh my gosh, how in the world am I going to incorporate El Conan boxes? And to our rescue came Emily Doyle, and she was teaching the other kindergarten. Well, this is how I do it. Now, every teacher that I've worked with that had to include El Conan boxes within this perky pace instruction has found a way to do it, and it's their art. But I think Emily Doyle does a great job, so I've included a video so you can see her doing that. This video, under classroom, you'll see it was the last day she was teaching in that classroom. She was going to be moving to another school. And so you kind of see like there's not a lot of in the room, and that's why. It's just that she's getting ready to move to another classroom. So let me show you how she does Ocone boxes.
First sound, middle sound, last sound. Ready? All eyes up here. Here we go. Boom. Et.
Bet.
Good. L. O.
Fell.
Good. O. S.
Less.
N. Et.
Net.
T. N.
Ten.
Good. Et.
Vet.
Good. My fault. Here we go. Yo. L.
Yo.
N. Eck.
Neck.
L.
Shell.
Last one. Ed.
Fed.
Good. Turn your bodies and kiss that brain.
Okay, so did you just see how quick and fast that was? Right, so I know when I was a teacher, I was a fan of the cookie sheet. It just made it out. Woo. Right, so whatever works for you. I was in classrooms last week where they had phone boxes on like a large easel and they just psh. So, but that is part, right? So we wanted to make these things visual. Here's the thing, too. If your kids are having trouble blending just with auditory, what does that tell you? They need more. Remember language by ear, language by eye, language by mouth. So, of course, if it was an onset rhyme, I might use spells and squares, right? The onset is a smaller rhyme, is a larger part. Or if it was phonemes, I might use these. Or I could use chips. You have, and then the kids see it, say it, move it. Anytime your kids are slowing down an instruction, they are telling you something. They are telling you, I need more scaffold. Anytime that you are teaching and they're answering you faster than you can get out the prompt, they're telling you, fade the prompt. Like even on Stephanie's video, I might think when she was deleting or adding, my sound is book at all, at the end and the word is ball, I think she can drop at the end. The sound is book at all, the word is ball. Don't you think so? Her kids don't need as much language. They're answering too fast. So that's the thing as teachers, the art of knowing when to add and when to pull away, right? Okay, so I'm gonna model for you two lessons for blending. And I'm just gonna do five prompts for the blue book and five for the yellow book, okay? So you have these, so you can pick. Now I chose week 18 of both core curriculum as your handout. Week 18, thank you. Is it pink and what's the primary one? Pink is, okay, so pink is the primary. So if you're a teacher who teaches first or second grade, you might want to use that one. And then yellow is the kindergarten, so it's up to you. I chose week 18 because it's like the middle of the pack of the year. There's 35 weeks of lessons, and so I just thought you would like to see like what does the middle of the year look like in kindergarten and what does it look like in first grade. All right? So you'll notice that that the instructions are right off to the left. So it says, and it's Thursday, right? We don't have to worry about that here. Teacher says, this is in the kindergarten, so we'll start there. Teacher says the individual phonemes, students repeat the individual sounds, and then say the whole word. So I'm gonna do the first five. Are you ready? You're gonna do them with me. W-A-G-A, repeat. Now blend. Ready? G. You guys are quiet. Come on. Ready? G. Ab. Do it with me. G. Ab. Ga. Ready? D. Ig. Ga. Do it with me. D. Ig. Dig. P. A. N. Do it. P. A. N. Hand. Ready? B. Ox. Ready? B. Ox. Box. Now, here's the trickiest part. If you're teaching this, like Heidi's facing me, right? Sharon is, Maria. You, as a teacher, have to do everything from right to left so that you see it left to right. All right? So in week 18 in kindergarten, we were blending what? C, B, C's. Okay, now we're going to go to the first grade. And you'll notice that we are blending with ending blends. Ending blends. So we ratchet it up over the course of the year. Are you ready? It says, teacher says the individual phonemes, students listen, and then say the whole word because you're pulling back the scaffold. Now, if I was doing this and the kids were looking at me like, I am lost, what would I have them do? Repeat. So I think you're adults, you probably can listen and get it, right? But here's the thing, you know, if it says students listen and your kids are looking like, I'm lost, do you follow the directions, yes or no? No. Teachers, you have the power, right? All right, so here we go. You're just going to listen, and then you're going to tell me the blended. All right, ready? M-F-O-T. You're so quiet. W-F-O-T. Thank you. G-A-S-P.
Yes.
O-F-N-D. O-F-N-D. Okay? So here's a cool thing I saw. I actually saw Lisa Mumo of Lingletown do this lesson on our PLC last month, which was really cool. She then said, well, you know, that's that kind of pilly thing you get on your clothes. And I was like, I love you. You just brought in language to phonology. Right? And she said to me afterwards, is that okay? I'm like, are you kidding me? Right? Think back to the rope. Of course I want you to bring in language. That's what you should be doing, right? So now you have a partner. You can choose to do the kindergarten or the first grade. Now here's what I'm going to ask you to do. You're going to do only five in the interest of time. So you'll do five and your partner will do five. That'll take you about maybe a minute or so to do. Make sure you're chopping from right to left. You should be facing each other when you're doing it. You're on the clock for a minute or so. I'm going to bring you back. Okay, thank you. Okay, some questions that came up about blending. Some schools that I work with, their phonics is Foundations, which is a very good phonics program. And so they glue sounds together, right? So if you're simultaneously using Foundations with a phonemic awareness program, you're going to glue those sounds as well, right? Because that's how the kids are learning them in orthography. You're going to have the same thing with phonology, right? So that can get a little tricky, right? But just follow, you want to keep things consistent between speech and print, all right? All right, so you did a great job. I saw a lot of chopping going on there. Okay, so we just did that. Okay, now here is the most controversial. I almost feel like I want you to do a drum roll like this, right? Let's do it. Okay, all right. This is the most challenging hand motion you're going to do. Are you ready? It is called the roller coaster. Okay, so the roller coaster is for kids to listen to the medial vowel sound. Okay, so when we first started implementing, what I saw was I was going into classrooms and the prompt might be cat. And the kids were like, cat, dog. I was just like, oh my God. They're having a great time. But are they learning anything? No. I mean, I wanted to have a good time. Didn't you think the kids were having a good time in the video? Sure. But I want them to be learning. So, oh, lordy, lordy, lordy. We had to really talk about the roller coaster. So some schools are so afraid of the roller coaster, they either punch it out to watch this. Ready? At. Right? And then, right? So we're going to see Emily Doyle's roller coaster because, again, I think Emily Doyle's roller coaster is the best. But here's what the Pam Kastner add-on. You can decide if you like it or not. So even with a good roller coaster, you'll see her roller coaster, she kind of puts it on the track and goes, at. So she's really pausing where that medial vowel sound is. But do I know that the kids have attuned their ear to the medial sound, yes or no? Do we know for sure, yes or no? No way, Jose. I don't. So the PM Kastner add-on is k at sound, d ah sound. I'm prompting for the sound. So let's try one. Do cat, I mean, try to keep your roller coasters happy. Ready? Cat, k at sound, dog, d ah sound. I'm only saying one word. Sound, 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 sound. See how clear, concise that language is? Is it taking me a lot of time? Nope, it's taking me 10 more seconds. Is it worth 10 more seconds to know if my kids are hearing the medial sound or not? Yes or no?
Yes.
It is. All right, so we did initial sound, then we go to final sound. Final sound is a punch it out. And you saw Stephanie kind of punching it out even for initial sound. She's gonna give them a clue. So let's do cat again, ready? K-a-t. Ready, dog. D-o-g. So where your fist is the target skill. Pam Kastner add-on, ready? K, a, t, sound, t, d, og, sound. I want to know, as a teacher, have you paid attention to the target phoneme I am demanding of you to do? If I don't do this, you're going to go cat, dog. It's wonderful. And the hand motions are awesome, but they're not telling me about what you know. All right, so I'm going to take you back again to our friend Emily Doyle, and we're going to look at her roller coaster. All right, and that's basically what I was showing you, the punch it out, and I was showing you the roller coaster. All right, so here's Emily Doyle's roller coaster. I think she rocks a roller coaster.
Good job, roller coaster's out. Roller coaster's on your track. Remember, bounce it on the track. First sound, middle sound, last sound, sweep the word. What am I looking for that?
Middle sound.
Middle sound. Here we go. Bed.
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 Bed. What sound?
End.
Good. Den.
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 Den. What sound?
End.
Awesome. Jet.
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 Jet. What sound?
End.
Awesome. Men.
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 What sound?
End.
Good. Pet.
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 What's up?
Tell.
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 Tell. What's up? Good. Wet.
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 What's up? Good. Ted.
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 What's up? Awesome. Guess.
Guess.
Good.
Guess.
Guess. What's up? Good. Head.
Head.
Head. Head. What's up? Good job. Let's do a silent cheer. One.
Like a roller coaster? Pretty good. You don't like a roller coaster? No. I can't tell because I meant maybe backwards. I don't know. I'll have to look at it. I'll have to look at the video again. So she's blending backwards, left to right. Oh, then we'll have to fix that. But I do like the right and this back here. And I think she can probably just drop the what? She can just say sound. Okay? All right. So I'm going to model for you. In the kindergarten and the primary. In the kindergarten, we're going to look at the Thursday, and it's asking me, the teacher says, students repeat the word and isolate the vowel sound with a roller coaster hand motion. Are you ready? So we're in the yellow. It's on the second page. At the bottom, it'll say the number 53, and we're on Thursday. So the prompts are hat, kid, lot, map, and fill. Okay, everybody ready? So I'm going to say the words, you're going to repeat it with a roller coaster. Are you ready? At. Do it back. At. Sound. K-id. K-id. Sound.
Id.
Lot. Ot. Sound. Map. App. Sound. Fill. Fill. Ill. Sound. Id. Okay, so that's kindergarten. So now we're going to move to the pink sheet. And in the next year, week 18, what students are doing is they're listening for a phoneme location. All right? Much like we listened earlier for initial, final, and the medial sound, now we're listening for where in the word is the blend. Is this hard or easy? Hard. It's hard. All right, so I'm going to say the word, you're going to repeat the word, and then you're going to tell me where you hear the blend, at the beginning, middle, or end. Okay, it's the pink sheet, and at the bottom it also says 53. Everyone with me? Okay. Say please.
Please.
Where's my blend? Mask.
Mask.
Where's the blend?
End.
Rainstorm.
Rainstorm.
Where's the blend?
Middle.
Friendly.
Friendly.
Where's the blend?
End.
Glitter.
Glitter.
Where's the blend?
End.
Yeah. So you're really getting to some really advanced skills, even a year later. I was talking to somebody back there, and they're like, I don't think I can do this. You know, this is like level N or something in Kilpatrick, you know, they're way up there. Okay, so again, kindergarten or first grade, the primary, you decide. You can do those with your partner, okay? So you're gonna practice either the roller coaster with a medial sound or phoneme location or both. We'll put you on the clock for like 1 minute. She was a Wednesday lesson. I can't think what skill word I was thinking about here. She was changing. Oh gosh, where were we? Yes, okay. So she was substituting phonemes. Now, normally when you substitute, you're using a hand motion like this, and you'll see it here in a minute. But what she did was, so for example, she was changing chose, ch-o's, and she was changing o to e. She used the roller coaster. Because can you grow more arms? No. Right, so she was, you know, co-opting the roller coaster to show I'm still changing this medial sound, but I don't have enough hands to do it that way. So she used the roller coaster, and so great job noticing that and bringing that up, because I knew that, but I just didn't share that with you, so thank you for that. Okay, so good job with the roller coaster, or the punch. If you're afraid of the roller coaster, you can just punch it out, right, like that? Okay, all right. So we're gonna move to segmenting. All right, of course, segmenting means when we're taking the sounds apart. Easier for kids to blend or segment? Blend. Segmenting is hard. Remember I said earlier, our job in instruction is to progressively differentiate the internal structures of spoken words for deep and accurate representation and phonological long-term memory, so they can map on those graphemes to that, right? So now we're starting to get into that internal structure of the spoken word, the internal details are really paying attention to that. It's really hard. All right, so again, we're going to be chopping, right? So let me just show you what one of them looks like. I'm going to go to kindergarten and segmenting. And again, I'm going to be on a Thursday. I say the word, you say the word, and then we chop. Are you ready? So you're on page 53 again. We're segmenting phonemes. We're on Thursday. Teacher says the whole word. Students repeat the whole word and use hand motions to chop it into phonemes. Our first prompt is going to be the word bat. Everyone's finger there? Are you ready? Segmenting. Here we go. Say bat.
Bat.
Ready?
B.
At. Ma.
Ma.
M. Up. Him.
Him.
Im, mm. Not.
Not.
Mm, ot. Can.
Can.
K, at, mm. Okay? So let's look at the primary. Primary is also on the pink sheet, and it says 53. And our first word is the word lift. Everyone have their finger there. You're all set? All right. So again, teacher says the words. Students repeat. So they're still repeating. Why? Why do you think they're repeating for this? Okay, yes, you want to make sure that the kids have the phonological word form in their mouth that you prompted. Also, this is an ending blend. Easy or hard?
Hard.
So you want that scaffold in there. They need it. They need that phonological word form in their mouth, and they need to be feeling those sounds, especially at the end of the word. Are you ready? Say lift.
Lift.
Oh, it. Milk.
Milk.
M, I, O. Ready? Hand. Hand. A, N, D. Ready? Help.
Help.
A, O. And last one we'll do film.
Film.
F, I, O, M. Okay, so your turn to practice with your partner. All right, you can either do the yellow or the pink, whatever floats your boat. Meaning. And I've used a scaffold that I already oral scaffolded them with. right? So that's the Pam Kastner add-on that I really encourage you to do, to add phonographic mapping to what you're blending and segmenting, all right? Okay. All right, so now we're at addition. Some people make the mistake that thinking addition is an advanced skill, but Dave says it's a blending skill, right? Okay, so we're adding a word or a word part. So let me model that for you. And I think I have to model that. Oh gosh, you don't even have one there. So let me go to the blue book and I'll just model one for you so you can see. Actually, we had it in week 22. We had it in the week 22 lesson with the white one. Okay? All right, here we go. It looks like this, the white one, and it's on the last page 66. Last page 66. All right, so we're adding a rhyme. Ready? Say d. Add eight, my word is date. Say p. Say p. Add each, my word is peach. Say, oh, I'm sorry, I'm not on Thursday. We're gonna go back. We're gonna put our finger on nest. Ready, my word is Oh my goodness, sorry. Say mm. Add eat, my word is meat. Say, add all my word, oh, say t. Oh, I'm sorry, say, yeah, say, add all my word is phone. Say s. Add ale, my word is sail. Say g. Add old, my word is old. Right, so you're adding a part, so I'm adding the rhyme, and I'm giving the onset. Sometimes you add here, too. So when you are doing this in your classroom, you have to be really careful where the addition part's going on. Some lessons, the adding will come in and they'll switch around. So go to your yellow, the white sheet, and you can just practice neat, phone, sail, gold, and page, the first five, okay? On Thursday, because today's a Thursday, okay? So neat, phone, sail, gold, and page. They are advanced phonemic awareness skills. We're not going to work on reversal because it's not within this curriculum, but reversal is an advanced phonemic awareness skill. All right, so with deletion, we might be saying, say cat, say, and now say it again without the, we're taking away. Sometimes I might say, say campground, now say it again without ground. Okay, that's a compound word level. Say, cat. Now say it again without the k, right? Say man. Say it again without m. All right, so you're taking away a part of a word or a word or the entire onset rhyme. All right, so let's look at the yellow sheet for, does not have a deletion. Let's look and see if we have one for, no, we do not, so we're going to just practice it together, all right? So let's just do a couple together that I'll do with you. Ready? Say campground. Now say it with, say camp without the ground. Say flashlight. Flash. Now say it without the light.
Flash.
Say garden.
Garden.
Now say it without the den.
Guard.
So we're just doing the syllable, right? Say cat. Say it again without k. At. What's left, okay? Say, I'm going to say, get rid of phoneme. Say, I don't know, little. Now say it without the ooh. So you're just deleting a part. Whatever part you're deleting, you're pulling away. You're saying what's left. Say cat without k. What's left is. Say rat without what's left is at. So you're just saying what is left and you're pulling that apart. I'm sorry that we don't have another one to do that with. All right. All right, now we're up to substitution. Right, and so why are we using these advanced skills? I want you to look right here about the correlation with segmenting tasks and manipulation tasks. What do you notice? Right, 0.29 and 0.47 here. Maybe worth doing, make a little difference. But where are we making our big difference? With manipulation. We're manipulating those sounds, deleting them, substituting them, and reversing them. All right? Okay. So, we're going to look at substitution. substitution. Now, substitution, you saw Stephanie when she was substituting a vowel. She was going ch-o's to ch-a's. She was using these roller coasters, which you have to do because you can't grow any more. Grow any more arms. But substitution normally is, it looks like this. So we're going to put our arms out like this. Are you ready? So I'm going to, you don't even have to look because you can't do that and have your hands there. All right, so ready? I'll just say the word, you repeat it. Ready? My word is map. Change mm to mm. And my word is? Yeah, okay, ready? My word is tip. Change t to s. My word is sock. Change s to ool. And my word is tap. Change t to mm. My word is map. My word is kid. Change k to ool. My word is lid. Right, so whatever part you're changing, you're moving that out and then just kind of bringing it together. So let's do it for, I'm going to model for first grade, ready? And that's what you saw Stephanie doing. All right, everybody ready? Say got, change ot to et, my word is. Say big, change ig to egg, my word is. Say pants, hen, change n to ot, my word is hot. All right. No, so you'll see if you watch the videos, the kids are like, they're doing it. Have you seen any of the videos? They are doing it just like you. All right, so just practice a couple with your partner, and then I think we're going to be closing up. So you can choose the pink or the yellow. All right, so I'm going to bring you back. Okay. So we're getting close to the end. I am more than willing to stay after and answer any questions you have. Here's the summary if you're teaching phonemic awareness. You want to deliver these in a comprehensive manner. You want to deliver them with a perky pace because if you keep it too slow, guess what's going to happen? You just suck your tongue out. Yeah, that's what's going to happen. Please, no schwawing. Let's everybody get our scissors out, ready? And stay together. Clip your sounds. Yeah, okay. Here's another thing that's really important. One thing that was misunderstood with the teachers is they knew that the pace was supposed to be perky, and the kids were making errors, and they were continuing on. Never, ever, never, ever, ever do that, right? Correct at the point of error. Model the correct form, have the kids model it as well, so they have that new memory trace of how it's supposed to be done, right? Always error correct. Everyone participates. Does that mean everyone has to do the hand motions? No. Some kids just don't want to do hand motions. If they're doing the skill, I'm in. I am not going to die on the hill to fight with a kid because they don't want to do the roller coaster. Right? Okay. Almost always, teacher says, not always, but almost always, teacher says what? Students repeat. And then phonemic awareness. Every day, okay? All right, so these are some resources which I'm sure you're very familiar with. And I will share with Maria the assessments that we did for the Hegarty, and they look like this. Students, notice how nicely they have how to respond for correct and incorrect. And so lots of scaffold supported there. And this is what a chart looks like. I don't have the student names on there, but it kind of shows you the skills that you need to use for small group instruction. The teachers are using, the reading specialists are using this in tier two, and what they're doing is they're double dosing, or they are doing a preview accelerate. If it's Thursday, they're previewing the Friday lesson. Here's another thing, Pam Kastner add-on. Once your kids feel comfortable with these skills, kids can hide in choral response. Say that with me. Kids can hide in choral response. So I might say, I would do beg. Do it with me in a segment. Beg. Individual term, Heidi. Right? So I might do, say individual term, give them think time. I'm not going to put it right on the spot. But when I start doing individual term, guess what? It ratchets it up. Now, am I going to do that to a child who I know will not be successful, yes or no? No. Never, ever, ever. But say that I have a low-performing child who's really starting to make progress. I'm so proud of him or her. And I've just seen them segment an ending blend. I want to celebrate that so the rest of the kids in the classroom can see that. And I'm going to say, oh, okay. accountable. Core responses kids can hide there. So think about individual responses. All right. So you have homework. Please, please don't miss this resource, this Padlet. Shauna Bradfield did this from our literacy team. It is amazing with many free resources that are aligned to the science. Okay. This is the Patent Literacy team. I'm your Patent Literacy Podcast. This is the, oh, and thank you for the honor. And you have to see this. Don't, there they